You're now more than 10 years after the start of the financial crisis. We had a banking crisis in Europe. We also had a sovereign debt crisis, a euro crisis. Now, overall, if we are looking back upon this decade, the ECB was lowering interest rates, providing long-term refinancing operations, buying a massive amount of debt asset purchases. Now, overall, was this a sound monetary policy? Was this a good anticipation on the banking crisis and everything that happened afterwards, according to you?
Thank you. I'm glad to be here. Just to tell you, I'll give you my views, not the views of the ECB, not the views of the IMF, but draw my experience and speak on that. And also, I haven't been involved in last year monetary policy anymore, but I was quite close at the time a few years ago. You mentioned last 10 years. It's interesting to see that a big difference with the US, the ECB has been there only for 20 years. So in fact, the ECB, it's quite different. Half of the existence of the institution was about creating and building up an institution, creating a European spirit, being there together, coming from all over from first 12 up to 19 countries. But really, it was very different. It doesn't have the experience of the Fed. And then for 10 years, it has been there as a firefighter, being there really on a day-to-day basis, fighting the crisis. And when you say interest rate decreases and so on, in fact, still in 2011, so several years after the start of the crisis, the ECB was increasing rates. The rate decreases came later. And in fact, the first years, I would rather focus as of 2012, where really, when we enter into a different crisis from the US, it was really the heat. Where if you look back, the end of 2011, early 2012, we are close to a credit crunch. There was no credit anymore to the private sector. Really, the total amount of credit was declining, not increasing. Then came an important risk of redomination in various countries, of the redomination risk of saying many markets were saying, no, that country will, there is a high probability that it will exit the euro, which has a lot of consequences economically and socially. And it's very different from what we saw, just a consequence on Wall Street. It is really a consequence on every person. There was a huge slack in the economy, very high unemployment, after a double dip because we had a crisis in 2009, but then came back also 2011, when with clear risks of deflation, we really see this when you look at, for instance, the protection against deflation in the market. There were big spikes at various occasions in that period. And above all that, you had a monetary policy transmission mechanism that was virtually dead in many countries. If the central bank was cutting interest rates, the rates to the private sector would not lower. It would not. There was a clear disconnect at that time. And now, what do we see 6 years later? Most of these threats have disappeared. Even if unemployment is still very high, and investment hasn't been back to pre-crisis levels. And I would say, all in all, there monetary policy has been very successful. But central bankers were not alone. Since 2012, a lot of progress has been made on the institutional side at European level, and also many reforms in several individual countries. And going back to 2012, you might remember the London speech from Mario Draghi at the time of the Olympics, where he said, whatever it takes. He only could make that speech because 1 month earlier, there was a European summit where the European leaders agreed to go for a banking union, to go for a kind of direct recap if necessary of banks, to go for also an ESM, a solidarity mechanism within Europe. Without that, the central bankers would never have dared to say whatever it takes within our mandate, as they did in July 2012. And so going then to monetary policy, QE is important, but it was part of a broader package at ECB, because you have QE, buying assets, initially private assets, but also sovereign bonds. But beside that, there is also an important element, is forward guidance, is providing clarity to actors about what are the plans of the ECB, having clear communication going forward, including on the sequence of how things will happen. There was a TLTRO, which is still there, where incentives for banks to provide credit to the private sector, and depending on how targeted their credit is, they will be compensated, really looking at that it trickles down. And then also the interest rates that went down to quite low levels. And each of these four elements are part of the ECB monetary package. They reinforce each other and they should not be seen separately. So QE is one of them. QE has worked via various channels, but it's not always the same in all countries and continents. It lowers interest rates in all terms, short term, long term, whereas a normal interest rate cut only has an impact on the short term. It has an impact on the exchange rate. It has a positive wealth impact, whereas people can invest, but this is a temporary, and this was less the case in Europe than in the US. It has a portfolio impact, where banks that sold assets to the assets purchase program. On the other side, what do we see? They were lending to companies that could not sell, didn't have bonds that could be bought by the ECB. So it had an impact also on other assets that were not directly linked to no direct QE actors. Okay. It had an impact on governments, because the governments had lower interest rates to pay and could make decisions in the short term, take stimulus decisions that were necessary given the high slack and the lack of demand that we had in the economy. And so all in all, it was confidence building.
Yeah. Okay. Geert Noels, a lot of economists say what the ECB was doing after the financial crisis, stabilizing the system, that was okay. But what happened afterwards with the euro crisis and the doing whatever it takes, that was not necessarily a good policy. Do you make a distinction between those two periods and how the ECB responded to it?
I think that the economy is an extremely complex system, and financial markets are also a very complex system, and that was the reason why central banks had a limited agenda, because if you start to disturb such a complex system, the complexity of what you have to manage also increases. And when I listened to my fellow debater, we start to lose a bit what are you targeting, and are you still in control of what you are in fact stimulating, and are you in control of the consequences of that? Because every impulse that you give have consequences afterwards. On the clarity of the agenda, I have a difficulty with Draghi, because when he said whatever it takes, it depends on what his target was. Was it saving the euro? Was it saving the Italian banking system? Was it saving the southern debt problem? We don't know. And there are still some other possible hidden agendas possible, and I think then you have a democratic deficit. And so, in my view, the entry of Mario Draghi in a certain way corrupted the mission of the European Central Bank, because it has never been very clear what his real target was. In my opinion, there was a hidden Italian agenda, and then it should have been communicated. And so the difference has been a difference in style. The mission of the ECB has never changed.
People in the ECB will say, well, our main purpose is clear. We need to create an inflation, a target of just below 2%. And as long as 2% is not reached, well, we go on with our policy. But a lot of economists, especially in the more northern countries, Germany, the Netherlands, Austria, they say, well, Mario Draghi is just using the 2% rule to become, a banker for Italy. But as long as there is no 2% reached, what can you do to change this policy?
I don't think the target is 2%. It's a moderate inflation between 0 and 2. And if you then, as an economist, you take the historic chart and you say, when was the inflation in Europe or any country in Europe anywhere stable between 0 and 2%, it's a limited period. And so if you have to target an inflation between 0 and 2%, it's already a very difficult target. I don't think the target was to reach 2%. I think there have been just other targets. And the inflation target has been misused or abused to target something else. Because suppose that today the average was already 2.2, I don't think that the ECB would drastically change its policy. And then we feel the hidden agenda, that it's more about the banking system, the debt problem, than just a 2% inflation rate.
Stéphane Bautier.
Yes, on this first, Mario Draghi is not alone. It's every decision is being taken by 25 people around the table. Everyone has a vote. Everyone is discussing. And there is no hidden Italian agenda because there is no hidden Italian majority. There is really everyone can discuss, can speak, can take a position. And so when you focusing, this was done for country, for banks, I would rather look at all these measures, hadn't they taken place? If you take the counterfacts, there was really, I see many governors from northern countries were really scared about what would happen. And they say, oh, we are really going to a catastrophe here. And without what had been done, ex post, it's easy to say, oh, it was for that of that. But without that, had the ECB, didn't they act? It was quite different from the US because we were really there with a double dip, with a high unemployment, with a redomination risk, a credit crunch. And so there was really an issue. And this was including, in, if you look at the rates in countries like even Belgium, France, in late 2011, were really high. And so it was much broader than one or two countries and than linked to one president. Then, so all in all, then the whole discussion in general, the ECB, I was there for 5 years around the board, and there is a real debate and a respect of arguments, and it's not one point of view or the other. It's much broader, a discussion which comes then with a decision, and it was never saying by being driven by one country or the other.
If I may react on it, I do think that the president of the central bank has an enormous power, especially because he creates his own staff. And it starts to influence it. That's not only so in Europe. I've been a couple of times to the Federal Reserve, and in Washington, when Alan Greenspan was heading the office, everybody in the Fed was strongly influenced by Alan Greenspan. I once asked to one of the 800 PhDs, when I was in a room one-on-one with him, is there any opposing voice? Is there any contrarian view within the Fed? And he said, no.
Yeah, but there is a big difference at the Fed. You have 12 people that vote, 7 of which are based in Washington. At ECB, 25 are voting, 6 are based in Frankfurt, and 19 are based all around Europe with their own staff. And going back to what you said about the 2% inflation, whether or not, the treaty says price stability in the medium term is the objective, and then it was defined as over time. And in tempore non suspecto, well before the crisis, under the leadership of a German chief economist that decided to say, we need clarity, we need to communicate to everyone what we do, and we decide it will be close to 2%. And so this was decided well before the crisis, well before the current present, under the leadership of a German chief economist.
And what is close? What is close? We are close to 2%. Is that close enough to keep these exceptional measures? When will it be close enough?
We are not that close.
It's how much today? How much is the inflation today?
1.3.
So we have to go between 0 and 2. When is it close enough? 1.99? 2.05?
It's in the...
I mean, and then again, you're talking also about unemployment. Clearly, it was on the mind of the ECB. If you truly believe that the central bank can sustainably decrease the unemployment rate, I mean, why would we have government and labor policy and companies? And I mean, this is the whole corruption in thinking. If you really start to believe, because you are in a powerhouse like the central bank, that you confronted with a problem in Frankfurt, you can lower unemployment, and you have to do that because it's your responsibility, you are wrong. Because there the problem starts. It's a responsibility of the countries. And you can facilitate, but you start jumping into conclusions. You say, well, there was a problem with credit creation, and credit creation creates employment. You can also think in other ways and say there is overcapacity, and there should be some cleaning up of some sectors and companies and zombie companies, etc. And countries should be forced to take measures to create the future employment, not to keep the old employment. And when you start mixing up and you start influencing, you start giving stimuli in the financial markets as a central bank, you stop this whole healthy process after a crisis of a recession of the economy, the power of the economy, starting to clean up the excesses of the previous boom phase. And that's exactly what the ECB did, because it extended, in fact, an unhealthy situation of before. And today, look at the banking sector. Not a lot has changed. You have to know, when I wrote my book, the launch was in 2008, on the day that Fortis went bankrupt. I can still remember the day, because there were a lot of politicians in the room. Even our our king was in the room. He was still prince at that day, and a lot of CEOs. It was the day that Fortis went bankrupt. That was the day. We are 10 years later. And if you look at the banking sector, a lot has changed in Belgium, indeed. But Belgium was one of the countries most hit by the whole banking crisis. And probably we took measures that were more severe for small countries, where in the larger countries, in France, in Germany, in Italy, not the same harsh measures were imposed on the banking sector. So in a certain way, our banking sector today is rather healthy, but I don't see the same health in the other countries. And so it's also a bit of not the same level, fairness level, because Deutsche Bank was mentioned. I mean, it's incredible to see that 10 years after the facts, Deutsche Bank is still struggling with complexity, with leverage, with hidden problems that apparently are not solved. So where was the ECB to attack these problems that are still very present and dangerous today?
No, I agree. I fully agree with you that it's not up to ECB to take all the responsibilities of whatever. And when I mentioned unemployment, it was the other way around. It is because as long as you have unemployment, you have no pressure on wages, and you have a downward pressure on prices. And so as long as this is the case, you won't have price. The ECB won't fulfill its mandate of price stability, but it's not I fully agree, it's not of the ECB to tackle the unemployment. I didn't say that, there was just a link. But on the banking side, a lot of progress has been made in the last 10 years, and I agree, some countries not. And the ECB has been in charge only for 2 or 3 years, and now apparently is cleaning up, is targeting non-performing loans and others. But if you see over the years, what has been done, for instance, in the banking sector in Spain, it's completely different from 10 years ago. There is a lot of banks were closed, a lot of...
Stéphane Rottier, yep. If you look indeed about to the NPLs, non-performing loans, for example, the system in Italy, it's still very fragile. We are talking, a lot of politicians in Europe as well, about convergence. But if we look back, there is still... on many dossiers, not a convergence. For example, the banking union. Some time ago, we had smaller banks in Italy. De facto, it were again bailouts. So as long as there is not a convergence, is it possible to have one monetary policy for an entire eurozone?
It is possible, but we have an agenda, and that needs to be fulfilled, and that needs to be implemented. On the Italian side, There was a very high stock of non-performing loans, but it is going down in over the last years. If you look at what UniCredit did, it's a quite important operation in terms of look at the amounts. It's minus 25% in 1 year for Italy in terms of non-performing loans. But beside that, I fully agree. We committed to have a bank, really a functioning banking union. You need a single resolution fund that has the same rules across countries. You cannot have a fragmented market, and there the ECB indeed, as a supervisor, doesn't go maybe far enough in terms of implementing common liquidity rules and really have a consolidated market for the banking sector, but the same with the single resolution board. You need a deposit facility, and so there are still quite some missing pieces, and there is quite some resistance across countries, but you really need it in the end. If you want a good monetary union, you need a good banking union, and a capital markets union. And for the banking union, you have an agenda that has not been implemented as what was committed in 2012.
Geert Noels, a lot of economists say, well, without QE, it would have been worse. Now, in her book, Mrs. Booth is talking about models. Economists are using the wrong models. Is it actually possible to calculate scientifically what the difference is that QA made in reality. Because Mario Draghi sometimes said, well, QA is making a difference, but can we calculate this? Is it scientifically possible to see what difference it makes, this monetary policy?
There are some computations that show that since 2014, for instance, the lending rates went down by 1% for households, 1.2% for large companies, and even 2% for SMEs. Based on, and just as a counterfactual computation linked to the impact of QE, there is some clearly on the credit side to small and medium enterprises and to the households, there's clearly an impact.
Here, Nils?
We can't deny that. Huh? So if you start buying massively bonds, interest rates go down. So you have an impact, that's clear. But what's the impact in the long run? Huh? So you also drive up housing prices. And so in the end, if you can lend more, but or you can borrow more, but the housing price is going up, net, I mean, households should be able to open an Excel spreadsheet and start computating what it means in the end. It doesn't mean a lot. Mm-hmm. So you're just having higher debt levels and higher asset prices. And surely the ECB has created a lot of asset inflation where it wanted to create inflation. Because you can't control where the money is going to. And they were hoping for inflation and they got asset inflation, where the central bank, in fact, should prevent asset inflation because it's extremely dangerous. And that's the whole point. A central bank was created, I think, a long time ago, I think in Norway and in UK, to prevent for the massive runs on the bank and to have something like an exceptional institute that in exceptional circumstances would be used. And it has evolved into day trading, where they intervene every day because if they don't intervene, the whole system that they have stimulated starts to collapse. And that's the whole problem. Central banks should be a bit like the firefighters that you never see because they do a lot of prevention. In Brussels, once upon a time, we had a big fire. And since then, the firefighters are in fact prevention officers. And they don't have to fight a lot of fires because they do a lot of prevention. And so they should make people afraid about the fire. And that's what central banks should do. Install a healthy fear. But what they are doing, and it was well described by you, is that since Greenspan, they took away the fear. They said, don't fear, because, and that's wrong, because these periods of fear make capitalists think about risk and hence give them the stimulus to do the right allocation of risk and their capital. And they should, in fact, bear their own risks. If there is that's called a moral hazard, that's an expensive term. If you start to install the feeling that someone else can take over your risk, of course, then the whole system collapses. And that's what you do because you're influencing the masses.
Yeah, if you look at the, I don't want to speak about the Fed, but if you look at the ECB for 10 years, they haven't intervened that much. But on the structural side, not much was done. On the fiscal side, not. And I really think QE has some negative side effects, we fully agree, and therefore it should be time-limited. But also, it's important that all the other policymakers do their job. And you mentioned the assets. There are some national macroprudential powers where people can really look at having rules of lending rules for households for mortgages. The fiscal side, not many governments, even now today, now that the sun is shining, governments are not really making efforts to build buffers for the next crisis. They are not being there, or no, we need to have a fiscal buffer, we need to put aside, when now is the time to do it, because the next crisis, if governments don't do it, what will happen? They might turn again to central banks, as you say. And the same on the, there are some distributional aspects, but here again, it's up to national politicians to have the policies to respond to it.
Stéphane Rottier, in her book, Fed Up, it's written, and it's a nice quote, and we can use it in Europe as well. I quote, due to the zero interest rates, pension funds taking risks to meet legal obligations, also in Europe, due to quantitative easing, there is a search for yield. How big is the risk that we get such a big bubble and that we have a new financial shock in Europe due to this interest policy? For example, due to pension funds taking extreme risks.
They're going back to the counterfactuals. I think what the central bank in Europe did was needed, because it would have been, if you talk to these pension funds, if you talk to the insurance companies, they said, without what you did, it would have been a catastrophe for us. But the way you tackled it also has consequences for what we do. And there, it's up to them also to adapt, to revisit their model. And hopefully, it should not last forever. And there, indeed, it cannot go on forever. But there, it's up to the institutions themselves to look at the way to adapt their model, and at the supervisors to make sure that unnecessary risks are taken. This is not a central bank issue.
Geert Noels, it can't go on forever, but isn't there a risk that we in Europe are facing a kind of Japanese scenario in the longer run?
Well, it's interesting to think about what will happen with Japan, because Japan is clearly leading on other countries. So they are, in terms of debt to GDP, on a whole different planet. The central bank or the postal office or whatever has bought a lot of the debt, and then what's next? And that's a bit the issue with QE. You start somewhere, and then if you ask to the specialists, to these PhDs, and how does this end? How do you solve when you have, 40% of GDP, of European GDP on your balance sheet, and how do you go further? If we would, with these PhDs, reflect on where would interest rates be today if the ECB wouldn't have bought massively all these bonds? They will, in general, say higher. Interest rates would be higher. We'll still say, well, there is a low inflation, etc. But everybody agrees it will be higher. How much higher? It's a debate. And if you then say, well, okay, interest rates would be higher. And Italian interest rates, where would they be? They would still be higher than the German one or the European average. Okay, how much higher? Well, so higher. We all agree higher. What would be the impact of 1%, 2%, 3% higher interest rates on asset inflation, on the current asset prices, sorry? It would have an impact. What would be the impact on the corporate sector, on refinancing? What would be the impact on the public sector? It would have a massive impact. So if you think in terms of Japan, what the Japanese story tells you is that when you start, you can't stop. And so you end when the whole central bank is 100% buyer of your bonds, or the postal office, or whatever, and you can still make believe that it's all working well. Now, the Japanese are a very passive kind of population. And so the day that the Japanese say, well, we are bankrupt and you don't have any money, I think the Japanese will say, oh, and they will continue. In Belgium, I don't think that will be the reaction in Belgium or in Italy or in France. People will revolt, will say that can't happen. So you're cornering yourself when you start something like that. I give you one example. You say there is a prudential regulation. For instance, the National Bank in Belgium should do something about asset inflation in the housing market. How, on the one hand, can you have a market desk of the National Bank buying bond issuance of real estate companies, 100% almost, so depressing their lending rate, creating bubbles, and then on the other hand, issue a warning against asset inflation in the Belgian housing market? That's not consistent. You can't buy for 100% all the issuance in the market and then on the other hand say, well, you should be careful because there could be a bubble. You're the cause of the bubble. So the first thing you should do is start intervening much less in the market. And we can debate on the fact if there is a bubble in the Belgian housing market or in commercial real estate or in whatever logistics real estate. But what you feel is that the current lending rates are not normal ones.
No, but the bubble is for sure, there might be in Luxembourg, in some German cities, in some places in Belgium, but it's not a European bubble. And so you have a European monetary policy, but the macroprudential policies should target...
Are you sure? Are you sure there is no generalized... If you look, for instance, at German housing prices, they have been flat for 20 years and they have started to increase now massively. You can't say it's just some cities. I mean, look around. It's an everywhere bubble. If you look at bond rates in all these countries, and it of course has been translated to all possible lending rates, how can you be so sure as European Central Bank there is no generalized overvaluation? it used to be easy for economists because you could spot a bubble from a very large distance, because when you saw a technology, you said, oh, that's a bubble. Bitcoin, you can say, yeah, it's a bubble, it looks like a bubble. But if you start inflating all asset prices, relative valuations start to become difficult to see where is the bubble, because everything is overvalued. It starts with the bond market, which is the biggest asset class there is. If you overvalue the bond market and you start putting everything compared to the bond market, nothing looks like a bubble anymore. Because you say, well, equities are expensive, but if you compare them to bonds, they are still very attractive. And where is your reference? Because the reference is wrong. And then all the relative prices start to be wrong too. So all these PhDs are now looking at historic references, relative prices against bonds, and they say, well, there is no reason to worry.
But for the housing, it can just be compared to the local revenue, to how long you pay, what is the rent, what is the other. And it's clear when you look at their analysis, and they show that it's only in specific places in Europe. It's not a general European housing bubble. No. There are quite some reasons.
I would be careful. Just giving you one example. Take the Belgian housing market. We still live in the expectation that housing prices should go up in the long run, so that there is no problem that they increase from time to time. But the whole housing stock is losing some value and should be depreciated because of energy measures, because of ICT necessity, because of access and mobility and whatever. So you can have a situation in which you're still thinking we are like looking at historic averages and historic patterns, but things are changing. And that's what a company is used to do, is think about also what is called disruption, about change. But in central banks, they still think that things can be extrapolated. And that's a very dangerous assumption. So that's a bit what is the problem within a central bank. If you put smart people together, you miss sometimes what we call boerenverstand, is people that say, oh, but did you think about that? And then they say, how can you? And often a problem starts over there, because in the bubble of all smart people, it lacks a bit people who say, well, you say that, but what we feel is that things are not normal anymore, and you think it's all normal, but you are very intelligent, but what we see in reality is that things don't add up. And that's a bit the problem with smart people together. In the markets, prices are not set by smart people alone. They are set by everybody. And you can't match that. So if you believe that only the smart people should set the price in a financial market, you're missing a point. The prices are set by everybody. And in the central bank, it's set by the smart people. And that's a big mistake.
But going back to Japan, they're still expanding. On the European side, 2 years ago, they were buying at 80 billion, then 60 billion or 30 billion until September. And after September, we don't know. What we know is that they will still reinvest. So I wouldn't compare and say, oh, we are here in the same scenario of building up forever. There is a trend change.
Yeah, we'll see what will happen. It has been announced. It's interesting to look, for instance, what Italy is expecting. So they expect a waiving of their debt. Interesting to see, because that's what I fear. It's always a bit, the basic problem, and financial markets and the economy are based on humans. And the main problem with the human being is discipline. You know, you said, I need a goal to train, etc. The same is for me. I like to have a goal and then go out for training. That keeps the discipline. And the discipline of financial markets in a certain way has to be kept by central banks. But if central banks don't keep the discipline anymore, the whole thing starts to erode.
But the same happens with on the fiscal side. If you have a stability and growth pact, if it's not respected,
it's not making things better.
No.
So that's the reason why we had the Maastricht Treaty, for instance. And I mean, if even the central banks are not respecting the Maastricht Treaty anymore, I mean, there you have it. All the discipline, all the contract. Because if you have pensions, it's for the long run. If you do something for the long run, and if you make a contract is made to keep the discipline, to have the boundaries in which you have discipline. Now, central banks, in a certain way, also have a contract. But if you let the boundaries go keep the discipline...
What is the contract?
Well, the contract is changing. It has changed since 2012. And so you're searching for the boundaries of the contract. The contract has changed.
No, the contract is fulfilling price stability in the medium term.
Well... Okay, but is the contract also buying 40% of GDP in bonds? So you can stretch yourself and say, well, it's still within the contract. I don't think it's within the contract.
Well, he did say whatever it takes.
Well, within its mandate.
And that's not within the mandate, because if you start saying whatever it takes, I mean, that's a statement which was a bit like gambling. I'm losing, I'm doubling my bet. If you're in trouble, double. That's what they did. And it worked out. They had to bet the whole house, everything they had, to still have an effect on the market. That tells you something about how far it went, that you have to say whatever it takes before the market still reacts. I mean, that says something about how you blurred the boundaries of what your contract was. That's my opinion.
But going forward, it also tells that if you go back to history, there was the idea of having the euro as a kind of crowning at the end when everything will converge in full. And the other theory is, no, we take it and it will be catalytic and we will converge and we'll do what we need to do. We will have fiscal discipline. We will take the structural reforms so that it will happen. And this did not happen the first 10 years. And then it came up to central banks. But also going forward, if you don't want them to do what you do that much to respect their mandate, it's up to others to act so that they don't have to go that far.
Well, I look a lot at other examples from real life and real sectors. For instance, constructing a dam or constructing a bridge. And with YouTube, you can see some failures also of dams and bridges. One of the big failures you can do if you construct a bridge is to forget a joint, because the joint helps you to absorb the seasons. And you were talking about the seasons when you started. Now, if you the euro is like a bridge without a joint, so it can't absorb anything. It's like a concrete bridge. And you see that the bridge will collapse because there are seasons and things happen and there is no way to absorb it. And then the architects don't say, well, in fact, the bridge was not well constructed. They say, we have to add more concrete.
Geert
it won't help.
Geert Noels, Emmanuel Macron and Angela Merkel are coming with the idea to transform the ESM into a kind of European IMF. Is that a good idea, or just going on the same wrong path in the Eurozone by...
I don't know what the plans are. I think, in my view, the plan of Macron is very easy. The problems of France are so immense that you can't solve it on your own. So France can't pick up with or catch up the competition gap they've created on their own. So they need money. And the easiest thing is other people's money, so European money. And so the whole discussion is now how to capture more European funds, how to capture other people's money. And that's the whole, in my view, the whole policy of Macron for the economy, but also for the financial sector.
Stéphane Rotier, Frits Bolkestein, former European Commissioner, once said, the problem with the euro is the southern countries, and he says also France, they want solidarity, and the countries in the north want solidity. Isn't that a problem, that we are not overcoming this cleavage in the eurozone?
I agree, and I think what Macron said initially, you cannot ask. I met him once, and the first sentence he told me is, I don't want to talk about solidarity without being responsible. And I think in what it has done the first year, there has been some steps in responsibility, and I agree with Geert Noels. A lot more needs to be done, but there has been major steps taken in terms of responsibility. But the two need to, in the end, the two need to go hand in hand. You need to really to have responsible countries and have some solidarity. Otherwise, if you don't have the one and the other, your monetary union won't work.
And if we look at the rules we have, Maastricht Treaty, Stability and Growth Pact, European Semester, isn't that a problem that Geert Noels is addressing, that each time no one is following the rules? So in the long run, it can't go on like this.
You need stronger institutions, indeed, and not only the ECB.
Okay.